I'm Tolga, and I did this work with a great set of people, actually. I'm quite proud. So this is about shifting this domain. You have, and this is great to talk here because you all had this introduction about the capsule networks and everything. I can just speak about the domain and how this applies and what kind of ideas we thought, right? So we go to 3D data. You have seen 3D data already. That was in video format, right? But video has this temporal component, so it's not actually a spatial axis there. All the frames are kind of correlated with the previous one. However, what happens when an independent axis comes in and this data lifts to true 3D? And this time, you have all these representation differences, right? The 3D data doesn't fit into one representation directly, immediately. So some of those are better for certain applications. And some others not. So, who has worked in 3D and who has worked in 3D deep learning, for instance? Okay, so that's very few. For those, please bear with me a little bit. It will be maybe a little boring, but I will first explain this domain and how we approached it. Okay, there are many different representations, graphs, octrees, implicit surfaces, all those things. And here, we want to do something different. Actually, this is very common. It's not that we invented this. But we want to work with point clouds. So the point clouds is a... what is a point cloud? It's basically a set. It's a set, not a matrix, even though this looks like a matrix, of attributes. So that you can have any d-dimensional attribute list associated to a point. And these attributes define certain things like location in space, the color of the object, differential properties of the object, and so on. It has many advantages. First of all, it's the raw and generic form of 3D data. Regardless of the sensor, it's able to explain the 3D environment. It's just a set of points and these set of colors. That's that pure, right? And therefore it's sparse, so it doesn't fill up the entire room. If you think about it, we actually don't fill up the entire room. So if you want to represent ourselves in this room, you don't want that we store all the empty voxels or the empty space around that's just air, right? So we can go to arbitrary accuracy as well, right? Because a point could go up to a floating point accuracy and there's no discretization on it, basically. Well, except the machine precision. Yeah, so. Though they are hard, of course, because they are now not like features or anything, because these are sets. It's an unordered sequence, and then it represents an unstructured geometry. It's not living in a grid like the 2D images. And then just because they are sets, they are also permutation independent, kind of. And if you take any CNN, that would be permutation dependent, rather. Right, so there is sparsity and there is density variation. So if I have a camera and if I shoot you guys from here, it will be like I have a lot of points in front of the scene here, like the stage, and then less points at the back because of this the angle between the rays, basically. Right? So you want to handle all of these things. And there is a particular network designed for this by Charles Chi. And what it does, basically, it just accepts the n times 3 point set, that is just the locations, as input to an MLP that is particularly designed in a permutation invariant way. And it extracts some local features per point, and then aggregates those local features with some form of pooling. There could be many methods, of course, to do this. Max pooling would be the simplest choice. Into a global feature, and then you can append any type of loss on it. So I will briefly explain what that is. So we have this input, which is n by 3, and then this goes through what is called an input transformation, which basically is a learned transformation kernel, like spatial transformer kernels. It will take the point cloud, rotate it into a canonical frame, such that our representation doesn't have to care about the rotation of the input. Right? And this is done in a two-level, with a two-level learned kernel. And afterwards, there comes these point-wise, one-by-one convolution operators to create rich feature maps. And at the end, we have the max pooling operation that aggregates down to the global feature, right? The latent space. And we can have many, many loss functions on this, just like a normal CNN would have. Okay, so this is, I would say, the de facto standard right now to process point clouds with deep networks. And on top of this, we want to build a new 3D autoencoder, basically. So of course there are 3D autoencoders, but which is more expressive and maybe more capable of doing other applications, right, that the others didn't have. So we will deal with shapes. Our input is a 3D shape. And we have an encoder, of course, this is an autoencoder, resulting in a latent feature. At this point, I want to say, I will take a different direction. Different direction in the sense that all these terminology that you know about the capsules, that will apply here, but we will see it from a different perspective. First, because it's a new domain. And second, different properties of the capsule networks will help us to do different things. Right? So the decoder, of course, and there's a reconstruction, and we will be measuring some kind of a reconstruction loss, of course, and in 3D that's usually the chamfer distance. So now comes the latent capsules, right? Now we see them as multiple latent vectors that we can play with. It gives you the ability to, you know, once we have all these vectors or all these capsules, we can do different things with them. Pause is obviously one of those. However, there could be other things. And we won't focus on pause, actually. So what happens is, what happens if you have multiple latent vectors, right? This is actually great. This is actually something that the other CNNs just don't give you. And it's different than having one single latent vector, one single long latent vector, just because, you know, there is this capsule idea and the routing and clustering on top of it. So what we can do, we can, for instance, take different capsules and make them specific to certain parts or anything, right? And we will actually observe that these capsules, when processed that way, just, you know, the architecture is just the same as a capsule network, maybe, with the modification that the encoder is a point net, and decoder, I will explain how we can achieve different decoders for point sets in a short while. So we see that these capsules, actually, what we can decode from them, they specialize into certain regions already without any supervision, right? So these are all the points that the capsules get localized to. They are just really reconstructing those parts. And, right, so I will come back to this in a second. And how we can formulate a decoder? How can we actually upsample a point set, right? Normally, if you have a 2D image, you would just memorize the locations of the max pooled feature maps and then use that during decoding, for instance, or you know, any other deconvolution operation and so on. In 3D, especially for point clouds where the input is unstructured, yet the output is also unstructured, this wouldn't hold anymore. So it's very hard to invent some points in 3D space. You know, just, you have to bring them from somewhere. There are many, many, many efforts, but I think a more principled approach, at least for objects, is this one. So instead of trying to make up points in 3D space, we think of this object as a two manifold, where you know, where it can always be unwrapped to a sphere or to a plane, right? And the idea is that if I take my napkin now, you know, some like a sheet, and wrap it around the object. So wrap that sheet around the microphone, and the deform. And instead of learning to make up points, I could learn the function of deformation. I could learn the parameterizations. So that's the basic idea that these guys called Folding Net came up with. Simultaneously, Atlas Net also came up with it. But yeah, so that's how we make a decoder for point sets, right? And now we look at different decoders. I'm not sure if you can see. Yes, you can. So what happens is in all of them, so basically, this guy, this fixed grid, right, this thing, is just a 2D plane. So this is sampled points on some 2D space. And then we have this global code, And this grid kind of combines with the global feature vector to deform on top of the output, on top of the actually the object that I want to reconstruct. So different decoders exist. And what they do is, the simplest one, of course, doesn't have the grid. It just has the latent vector and decodes or reconstructs the output from that. It's quite hard. And then there is this folding net that just uses one set of grids to decode an entire point set. Well, that is somehow limiting, of course. And then comes AtlasNet. It basically takes a feature vector and then multiple grids. You can think of it like multiple patches surrounding the object. So I have these multiple napkins now, and I'm wrapping them around different parts of this object, right? And of course, this is more capable of, it's richer and results in better reconstructions. What they don't have, though, now, they are all limited to this single-dimensional latent vector that we cannot really use, right? I mean, I cannot really control this vector to the parameters of the shape. I cannot instantiate it as in the capsule. So now we can have these multiple feature vectors, right? That is really good, and we can see what happens in a second. So let me briefly give you the architecture. So we have a point cloud, n by 3. We have a neural network that processes it as raw, consumes it raw completely. And then, of course, results in some feature maps, right? These convolutions are, again, on top of the points. There is no neighborhood because we are also permutation invariant. So from that, now you branch this feature map off to create these, different capsules. And each of these feature maps in themselves get this aggregation. Now we found this primary point capsules, which is a concatenation of all these things. Now comes the dynamic routing that routes these primary point capsules to the latent capsules that I actually want to have. Right. And just like the original capsule networks, we will have a decoder right there. But now we will have this idea of folding a napkin for each capsule. So we take these capsules and then append different grids on top of these capsule maps. And then combination of each one of them basically results in certain reconstruction of the object because of the decoding. So remember, we learned the deformation function. We don't invent points, right? So we just deform these grids on top of the 3D. And that is just learned by some MLPs. That's what deforms the grid. Okay, and then we end up with this reconstruction. And we see immediately that the same color represents the same capsule, okay? That we see that they don't just distribute across space. They choose certain regions of space to reconstruct, right? And that has multiple reasons. Primarily, I mean, we have the routing procedure there. You know, that's kind of a clustering already, plus, these decoders are, so that is also an argument going on, it's debatable, but I would like to give it to you, is that they choose the easy things to reconstruct. So if I'm basically spreading out these reconstructed point across space, that is basically I'm deforming my napkin too much. However, the network or any optimization algorithm will converge to something that actually doesn't move it that much, doesn't want to move it that much. So why keep them? Distributed, whereas I can keep them local? So of course this immediately calls for part segmentation, right? Because now we have already these things across different parts. And what happens if I supervise this thing now? So I will just take a part segmentation data set, so some data set where the objects are labeled with parts, and then I will make my capsules specific to those parts. Now just, hey, this green thing that is over there, I have the input label for it, right? And then I will just sample the part labels for it and associate. And that's it. And I can do this for multiple capsules coming from, the same parts, or multiple capsules can come from the same part. And then I can just do my predictions, right, after some labels. And of course, there will be some loss to classify them to supervise thing in the end. And I can now do the part segmentation, because from the latent space I can go to these part predictions, right? And then I can also know, I also know the association to the latent capsules. So I decode. That is possible. Therefore, I end up with these part segmentations, which look like those. And it's pretty close to the ground truth. So I don't have much time. Therefore, I will not pause on them too much. But they are actually good. And then we can do other applications now, because we have a rich latent space, right? It's not like typical features. So what we can do, we can take a source shape, encode it, get its parts, right? And then we can take a target shape, encode it, get its parts, right? And now we know the association between the wings, because the wings now, we have them in the latent space, we can control them. So if I just switch the capsules for the wings, I'm actually ending up with two planes, the parts are flipped in a consistent and globally coherent way indeed. And that looks like that. So it's really fine in that sense. Right. More examples. Actually, I would skip that, but I would show you this. So the interpolation is also smooth without any head-on loss on this, right? It's really just, we are interpolating the latent space only. And you see the topology, of the two legs of the table, they come together, so it can also handle topology changes. We apply it to 3D feature extraction, get the state-of-the-art results, of course. We also do other things. We do multiple applications now with this, right? We just take any application where the point clouds are used in an autoencoder and just apply our thing. And the results are actually really good. So, thank you for listening. And I just have a couple of take-home messages. I think the input representation is quite important for applications, plus how we parameterize our latent space, how we impose its structure on our bottleneck features is actually important. Right? We want to make it rich, we want to make it structured, maybe with some geometry, with some meaning. That's important. And now we are working on specializing capsules on other things, like 3D pose, deformation, whatnot, you can imagine. So the code is available, you can play with it. And I thank all my collaborators for this. It's, for me, it was very enjoyable. Thanks a lot.